So, first question is to you, Jason, and I've got questions for both of you, so both of you will get a chance to respond and talk to one another about this as well. But my first question was, how long you've been listening to Henry's music and what attracted you to it is my first question.
My father had a pretty wide record collection, and I used to go through it endlessly looking for hip-hop samples. And in the 80s, around that time, he also had like a lot of the AACL music. Somehow, it found a stronghold in my father's Houstonian record collection.
Yeah.
And then one day, he gave me a tape. He said, you need to listen to this. And it was the record, it was a tape of Too Much Sugar for a Dime. And I thought, okay, this is way different than anything else I've ever listened to.
Yeah.
And it more gave me a lot of appreciation for my father, because he said, okay, you as a kid need to hear this dense, incredible music.
Yeah.
And so from that point, I would start to go back and find the earlier works. And over time, he became, Threadgill is my favorite composer of all time, because just the breadth of composition, the types of ensembles, the originality of methods, of sound, everything. So this is why he's my favorite.
Yeah, that's what I thought, but I wasn't a kid when I first heard. I have to say that you are so incredibly busy, so much in demand, your work at the Kennedy Center, so many things that you're doing. What provoked you to come up with this idea of actually curating a Threadgill project?
Well, I think a couple of years ago I approached Mr. Threadgill and asked him, would he even be open to the idea of this kind of event happening?
Yeah.
Because it was mostly out of a yearning to hear some of that music live in person again.
Yeah.
Because Threadgill moves on, you know. and I knew that so many musicians in my generation praise and honor him as a composer and that work. And so I thought, as a gesture, you know, of the many musicians who have taken inspiration from his music, to a way to kind of honor him was to just, like, let's revere this gift that is here, a composer who continues to make new forms, you know, over and over again. It's the inspiration for us young musicians. So I thought that it would be beautiful if we could all come together to just kind of give a very long applause to the master.
And how did you come up with that fabulous name?
Well, right here.
I'm good at naming stuff. I don't work, but I can name a lot of things. And I have great fun doing that.
Jason, did your father play music?
No, he didn't. Mm. He had a little flute that he used to toy with.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, he saw everything that came into Houston. You know, any band, he was going to check it out. So, you know, I felt like that was part of, you know, actually he and Threadgill met for the first time. I had premiere at Jazz Lincoln Center, and I called him and I said, I would love for you to come here.
Right.
This new piece.
Yeah.
And so Threadgill sat next to my father. My father was just like, oh man, I'm sitting next to Threadgill. He was like, so we just talked about that 2 minutes ago. So
that was the Rose Room.
Yeah. So, you know, like, that was also a moment where, I meet a lot of people, and people that you kind of really are diehard fans of, you want them to hear the work that you're not so sure about.
So here I
made this new piece, and I was like, the best composer I know is Mr. Threadgill. Like, to have him come, to even know that he was there as I tried to perform this thing was, it was just a start.
That's great. Jason has spoken about your technique, about your compositions, and how important they are. And I'm wondering if you can describe what that technique is and how it evolved over the years, since I'm one of the people who saw it and heard it at the very beginning. I'm curious about that, when you started composing, all of those things, what your influences were to arrive at that technique.
Well, my influences are so wide.
Right.
When when I started looking from the viewpoint of black music, gospel music for one thing, I grew up around gospel music and the blues. I mean Chicago blues, which is like Delta blues,
yeah.
Muddy Waters and Howlin' Wolf. Mm-hmm. I was really taken by Howlin' Wolf from the time I was about 3 or 4 years old. I was under the spell of Howlin' Wolf all of my life. Because I used to, when my grandfather would take me to what we call Jewtown, which was Maxwell Street in Chicago, they would play out in the street on Sunday morning, very early in the morning, on the platform. And I would just stand there and Howlin' Wolf would just have me, I'd be like in the spell, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And the same way with gospel music. And then it was another thing growing up at the time that I grew up in Chicago and probably all around the country, radio was mm-hmm. extremely important prior to television. Radio was like, was as diverse as what early TV was like. Early television was extremely diverse
right.
before it became institutionalized and commercialized.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I was always into music from far back as I can remember, and all day long the music would change on the radio.
Yeah.
There would be Polish music would come on, you know, and Chicago being like the largest Polish community outside of Warsaw mm-hmm. and the largest Serbian music community, mm-hmm. so Serbian music was always on the radio. And then general classical music would come on. And I would just sit and listen to it all afternoon, you know. And then rhythm and blues and that whole period of boogie woogie. I mean, that's when I first started playing music.
Mm.
Was doing the I'm when boogie woogie started, exactly when it was like being broadcast over radio. That's when I heard it and taught myself to play the piano. So I had all of these. I started off with all these kind of things, and Chicago being another thing was like, Chicago is a parade town.
Mm-hmm.
I made my living in Chicago playing in parades. Mm-hmm. You know, I could play 2 or 3 parades a week and pay my rent for the entire month and pay every other expense.
Wow.
I did that for a long time, you know. The segregation, you know, they always say Chicago is as far down south as you can go up north. Well, those lines, that meant nothing when it was a parade, because, you know, who takes over parades? Politicians. Politicians always got a platform to deliver at a parade. So, like, we were going to the Polish community, any kind of community, you know, in a parade, you know, as soon as the parade was over, go back to where you come from. So, marching bands, I grew up around marching bands, too, so, like, I had all this in my background, just starting out just primary, and like I said, then I had like these two types of religious music, which was like my one grandmother was in the Church God of Christ, which is Sanctified Church, which was my favorite. Then my other grandmother was in the biggest Baptist church in Chicago, which was Olive Baptist Church, and most of these singers were all professional singers.
Yes.
They sang anthems, you know. I remember the professor there that why he was had a doctorate in music.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I wasn't so crazy about that as a kid. I appreciate that because the things that would happen at the Sanctified Church, I mean, you know, they would really go off, and I kind of like that. I like the going off part, you know. So, but and then that was the home of gospel music, you know, mm-hmm. it was being published there. When I started writing music, I first started trying to write music, I guess, about the time I entered high school.
Mm-hmm.
It was funny, about 5 or 6 years ago, Joseph Jarman, who I had a long relationship with, Joseph found an envelope in a trunk of his, and it was the first two pieces of music that I wrote.
Wow.
And I always wondered what happened to these two pieces of music. One was on one side and one was on the other. I met Jarman when I first entered junior college from mm-hmm. high school. And I had written these two pieces of music, and one was called Ornette, and another piece was called Gray. And I'm cleaning out my musical trunk right now, and I found them again because obviously I gotta find that, those two pieces of music, you know, because they're the very first two things I ever wrote.
Yeah.
You know. So, living in Chicago, also the University of Chicago was not only a scientific center, but it was a lot going on musically. It was a guy there named Ralph Shady that had the Chamber Contemporary Music. It was a contemporary music ensemble, and they played all only contemporary music. That's when I first walked in and sat down and Pierre didn't know about Sherberry. I thought I was going to lose my mind. I couldn't believe it. There's any music like that. You know, I just said, how do you do it? Uh-huh. What does it look like? I met Varez there. I heard his music there. I met Hindemith there. Mm-hmm. And his music was being played. I met all of them when I was like still the first entering college, you know. And so I began to look at all of that music and started trying to understand how people was putting music together. Besides the whole tradition of like jazz from back from Scott Joplin on to Jerry Roll Moore and Scott Joplin, Duke Ellington, Charlie Parker, Bud Powell, you know. All of these, the longest one, all these different people, I've always looked at music not as like one avenue from which I was to draw information. I always looked everywhere,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Opera, I've always loved opera, and just European music, music from Indonesia.
Yes.
Everywhere.
I remember the music from the, you know, part of when I entered Henry's life in Chicago.
Right.
And came in, Emilio and I visited him in his apartment. I don't know if you remember this, but you were so excited about this Indonesian monkey chants.
Right. Oh,
and
yes,
you
right.
had them play, you were blasting them out. It was just like, damn, this is way out. And your enthusiasm for it was so incredible. So I remember some of those influences. And you talked about a number of things that I wanted to touch on. You did not speak about Sun Ra.
Uh-huh.
And I'm just wondering if that was a part of the mix of Andrew Hill. Was he still in Chicago?
No, Andrew had left with Sun Ra. Sun Ra, Phil Corrant, and Muhammad Richard Davis, they were, actually Sun Ra was the very first person that I came in touch with. I met Phil Corrant. Phil Corrant tried to recruit me when I was very young, about 15 or something like that. I met him on the train and he kind of freaked me out. He was talking all of this way out stuff. And Phil Corrant is an Egyptologist, you know, he's a historian. And he was like, it was just too much information, like, you know, kids, you know, far too much information.
Right.
It was like far too much information
right.
for me, you know.
Yeah.
But somehow rehearsed in the neighborhood, where, you know, in Englewood. So me and Absalom, Ben Shalom, we grew up together.
Mm-hmm.
And Ronnie Borkins lived over there, the bass player with Sun Ra. They rehearsed in a meat market that specialized in wild game.
Wow.
It was on 63rd in the morning. And in the daytime, they sold bear meat and, you know, boars and deer and everything to think of. At night, this guy that owned it, he was a Greek guy, he liked Sun Ra music. They would go into the back and he would let them rehearse in the back. And that's where we would go and sit while they rehearsed. Absalom and I would sit there, you know, Sun Ra would be doing this thing, you know, Pat Patrick, this also saxophone player's brother that was with Diaz, Henry Pryor.
Uh-huh.
The Pryors lived in, I grew up with Harry Pryor, he was another trombonist, but it was another older brother played trombone with Sun Ra. And Charles might have left by then, Charles Davis.
Mm-hmm,
but son, John Gilmore.
Yeah.
And Ronnie Borkins. So, you know, I was listening and studying that music, you know. Not being able to study it physically on paper, but just the unusual structures. I was saying, I said, this doesn't move the way other music is moving. That's what unusual, you know, when you're young, you know, you look at a pattern over here, you see a lot of music, and then something else jumps up, you say, wait a minute, I thought this is how you do it, you know, and then this jumps up, and this jumps up,
right.
You know. So we stayed up under Sun Ra for a very long time, until they packed up New York. We packed up. And we were, I mean, I used to go see him every just about every few nights. He was downstairs at the Persian, and Amin Jamal was upstairs.
That's
amazing. So we would go see Amin Jamal, you know, if he wasn't being too sensitive, and somebody would start talking, he'd get up and leave the room. Amin Jamal was tripped then.
Early on.
Somebody dropped a glass, that's it, through playing. You know? So we listened to them and stayed with them till the day and night that they drove off to New York, you know. And then I met Moran, but when I was in college, soon as I got in college, we had a music club, and I don't know how it came up that we picked Moran, and it was a great bass player from Chicago named Betty Dupree, bass player. But it could have had something to do with Malakai Favors or somebody that knew Moran. We were all in school together, Malakai, Jack, Eddie Harris was next door, and Bunky Green was next door. But they were older, but they were at City College, so it was Roscoe and Jarman and Drysia and it was so many incredible musicians at the school. It was like unbelievable.
Yeah.
You know. And somebody recommended bringing Moran in. And so he had a concert, and that's where I first met him. And he had, at that time, he had started the experimental band at CNC's nightclub, big nightclub on Cottage Grove. That was like the whole music district. And he invited me over there.
Yeah.
I went there and I went and read some of the music, and then he asked me if I had any music I wanted to bring out. I took over a piece of music. It didn't go so well. Eddie Harris was playing lead alto or something. He said, it wasn't anything wrong. I thought the music, I was just playing the musician. They were making little criticisms. I said, I don't think you understand what I'm doing. You know, I said, I might be young, but I know what I'm doing.
Let me ask a question about that in terms of the compositional things, and then I also want to ask both of you, because you've raised a couple of phrases that I wanted to kind of clamp down on, because the history is so rich. I know we could go on with this forever.
Right.
I know you've got the memoir coming out and the conversation that's going to take place during the performance. I was interested in finding out whether you were looking at what you considered in terms of the compositional technique, taking all of those influences and then looking at something that would be considered simultaneous improvisation or simultaneous compositions that were played simultaneously. Because when I see the musicians playing your music, and I see them playing from a score, at the same time they're all doing something different.
Right.
And I was thinking about, and this may be so off, but I will embarrass myself by being off. I was thinking about Louis Armstrong's those early Hot Five records, because whether it was improvised or written, you were hearing, before the kind of soloist started to kind of emerge and kind of take over in terms of the format of the music, there were all these simultaneous voices being heard.
And the music was very contrapuntal.
And I'm wondering if that is what you consider a signature of your music at this point, because it seems to be a thread that has gone from the very beginning.
You know, I've always been interested in, from the very beginning, interested in how to have two or more voices act completely independent.
You know,
I've been working on that probably all my life.
Yeah.
You know, even if I sit down and try to write a piece for a piano, I'm only concerned about how I can get something, that I can do something in this hand that's different from this hand, or something in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
It's something that I've been chasing for years.
Yeah.
And it changes, only it advances because my musical concepts change. I move from what only change when I've actually made a move.
Sounds like one of your titles. Wait, I remember that. Subject to change without notice.
Did you know what I mean? Look, when I completely finish the area that I'm working in, when I've done everything I can, if I'm lucky, I've been lucky, and if I'm lucky, I can see the next move, mm-hmm. you know. And in that next move, it always frees me up in terms of the independent writing
yeah.
of voices.
Yeah.
Because that's what I'm always chasing anyway.
Yeah.
You know?
And you can see, also you can see when you land on it too.
Right.
You know, because yes. you can hear it. I went to, you know, the set at the Vanguard. I was there for three occasions and I was spellbound in each of them. But you had said something else and I wanted to ask you both about this because I think it's important to our understanding, certainly as Harlem Stage, as an institution, we're constantly concerned about freeing artists from labels
mm-hmm.
and not trying to put them in a box.
Right.
And I think that that's what they most appreciate.
Right.
But one of the boxes that exists, and it's such an obvious one, is this idea of black music. You
right.
use the term.
Right.
And jazz.
Right.
And I'm wondering how you feel about those two terms, both of you, how you feel about those terms, whether it is a boundary
mm-hmm.
that you want to step out of or something that you want to embrace. So maybe you can talk about that.
You do want to step out of it. In the society, when it restricts you in terms of like you being defined on a racial basis, you know what I'm
yeah.
saying? That this is white music, this is Asian music. So what happens is, they had an article just recently, about a week ago, or so, about black composers in the New York Times. I don't know if you saw it.
I did.
And where you never really, T.J. Anderson is the main person that is being talked to, the senior composer of this country, black composer. He's about 85 now.
Mm.
And it starts off, I think the title is like The Invisible Man. And it was something I learned in this article that I'd never knew before, was that Ralph Ellison had started out as a composer. And because he saw that he couldn't go anywhere, that he was going to be restricted,
yeah.
that he switched over to literature.
Yeah.
And T.J. Anderson brought up exactly what happens, that like you'll never, he said, I know that the Metropolitan Opera or the New York Philharmonic will never commission me.
Yeah.
Well, that's a pretty much of a drag mm-hmm. in your lifetime. You know, or a kid comes up and say, you mean to say I can't play baseball?
Mm-hmm.
I can't dance
yeah.
on a Radio City Music Hall. That's pretty much of a drag, you know.
Yeah.
So that's the restricted part of the idea of being defined on a racial basis. Now, the music that we've been associated with, this improvised music,
yeah.
this music has now, time has passed, it's all kinds of people in the equation now.
Yeah, yeah.
Playing this music from Vietnam and everywhere else.
That's right.
You know,
yeah.
that was not the story in the beginning.
Right.
But now,
yeah.
we got whole groups of people from Puerto Rico, Cuba,
right.
Korea, everywhere.
Yeah.
And we don't know what their contribution is going to be in
right.
terms of the evolution of this music,
right.
you know. And one thing that a lot of people have to remember about black people in America is a result of just what Evan Lincoln said, I got a whole lot of people in me.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, you know what I'm saying? It's like, it's not like black people in America can't be defined like people from Ghana. They're not from some territory. We
exactly.
got everything, they're
yeah.
a mix of everything. And so once you understand that, then you're going to have a mix of everything culturally.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So you can't stop that.
You know what's interesting about that too is that a part of my whole kind of impetus to do what we do here
mm-hmm.
and that I've done in my life and throughout my life is that the thing that I've called black music
mm-hmm.
has been such an inspiration for me.
Mm-hmm.
I cannot imagine being me in this society
mm-hmm.
without the pride that I felt in that cultural achievement, in that cultural
mm-hmm.
presence, you know. And it's interesting because you've talked about people coming from all over. Now,
mm-hmm.
you know, we do a lot of work with Jay Iyer, and he's performed your music.
Mm-hmm.
And the Jay, when he got the MacArthur, talked about playing black music.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that that was an acknowledgement that was important because he was defining a territory for himself without putting himself in a box.
Mm-hmm.
So tell me what your thoughts are, please, about this idea of black music, jazz, how we've come to this place and what it means for you as an artist and for us.
Those both of those terms generally equate to therapy for me. meaning without either one of those, that's how black folks in America have kind of approached many of their fears, their issues, their, you know, their barriers and boundaries, and they come out through this sound, which then goes around the world and people become transformed by it.
Yeah.
So I can be all the way in Vienna after watching Randy Weston play a show, then the DJ comes on stage and he plays nothing but 1950s Motown. All the way in Austria, you know, like,
yeah, right.
So that's a night of music for them.
Yeah.
And it's a night of inspiration for a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not, I mean, the same way that people still gravitate to pop, or they still gravitate to Brahms, and now to Howlin' Wolf, and to you know, Biggie Smalls or whatever. There's something in the sound of and how we present it, considering our experiences, that is not separate from the music.
Right.
It's like woven in, that DNA is embedded in those notes.
Right.
And that code is there, and I think some certain listeners feel that in a way.
Mm-hmm.
So despite whatever term it is, it's that which I think most artists generally are aiming for.
Yes.
That kind of clear connect from all of my life's experiences now into my horn, and you can feel it when it actually comes out.
Yeah.
You know, when we were watching Threadgill at the Vanguard just a couple weeks ago, and he had worked his way to his alto saxophone, I just remember feeling like he had just sliced a hole into the roof of that building, in that tiny basement, and, and light was like now streaming in full force. It was unbelievable, but that's as much about him as a person and all the people in him as much as it is about the note he played, you know? And it's the placement of those things that is transformative. And so I know the kind of music that has always been a major part and what I feel and what I want to impart into my celebration of black music.
Yeah.
You know, because I think people are constantly informed by it, and many people are cured by it, you know? And that's an aspect that I want to maintain.
We're doing a whole series on black music, discussions about it, to understand kind of where it's come from and where it's gone. So I think it's very important that you all, in this conversation, are kind of freeing me up and us up as an institution to kind of go forward with that discussion in a way that feels right and not limiting, but embracing all of those elements that you've both spoken about.
Let me just add one little thing for that. When you're talking about, in my viewpoint, any kind of black artist, especially ones that have come before and established the groundwork for black literature or poetry or music, what have you, they did not just use black material as the basis for their intelligentsia.
Yes,
To inform them, one had to become to be aware of what is the information in the world today.
Yes. Yeah, that's right.
And this is what made these people who they were, but this is what made them great.
Yeah.
And this is what made their art world music or world art.
Yeah.
It's because they were able to tap into the latest and the most advanced information on the planet.
Right. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
It's wonderful.
Yeah.
And I'm so glad you said it, because that has been the essence of who we are.
Exactly.
And how we can survive. Because without it, there is no survival.
Right.
But I wanted to conclude, because this has been such a great conversation, and I thank both of you. But I wanted to ask you both, you know, how it is that you came to want to do this project at Harlem Stage, and how you feel about both of you, how you feel about having it happen here in Harlem.
To have it happen in Harlem is wonderful.
Yeah.
I mean, because, you know, Harlem has got this history of things that happened here, and then it has this history of periods where nothing happened. You know? And now this is like of returning, you
right.
know.
Right. Yeah.
And it's a similar problem around the country too. You know what I'm saying? Well, I grew up on the South Side of Chicago. You didn't have to leave the South Side of Chicago to hear any great music. Mm-hmm. So much music when I was growing up was ridiculous. Yeah. You know. And so it's the same here. You know, mm-hmm. to have it happening here. How much? Who will come out? It doesn't matter how many people come from this community or any particular community. As long as people come,
yeah.
because it's not that small.
Yeah, right.
You know what I'm
That's
saying?
Right.
It's not
yeah.
that small.
And Jason, you came to us, and we just thought we'd hear from you how you chose to come to us for this celebration.
You all live two blocks away from me. But also,
it's the shortest distance so many, between two
yeah,
points.
But so many years, I've been not only coming here as a visitor, as an audience member, but also as a performer. And things have been born here, ideas have been born here. I've watched things happen on these stages. And this is what I know that is part of you all's mission, to challenge everything. And to celebrate a composer in this way, I thought this would be the great kind of contribution that to the program, that we can celebrate Mr. Threadgill in a way where not only his music community comes to celebrate and applaud him, but his audience comes, and you know, national public radio comes, and that this yeah. becomes a thing that we can continue to celebrate, and we do it out of pure love
yeah.
and passion for the work.
Thank you. And you know, we're so blessed that you came and to us with this idea, and I feel so blessed to be able to be with the two of you, mm-hmm. because Henry is so much a part of my beginning in the introduction of this and love of this music, and you're so much of the continuum for us, and to have it all related in this way.
This is going to be so great for you. I mean, historic. I mean, to as people say, to have this on your resume. it shows a focus where you are focused on people that make art.
Yes, yes.
And there's a record of it.
Yeah.
You know, and that can't be erased. And yeah. I think down the line, it will serve to strengthen where the institution is going.
Yeah.
Because it will show what you've been doing in that way. Like, you know, it's not like you just did this today one time and now you're asking people like to pay attention to you. No, you see, this is part of our program.
Yeah.
This is a continuous program.
Yeah.
You know. And it doesn't just serve the artists, it serves the community. People always forget that art exists in its time through society and cultural things that come together.
Yeah.
Cultural, spiritual, and social information
yeah.
is what is the basis for all art at the time that it happens.
Right.
The next period, artists create things in the same way with society,
mm-hmm.
culture, and spiritual values.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so you all would have that as a continuous thing, and that's what would be great.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's been so